Hello everyone, I welcome you to my YouTube channel Professor Civil Mandal. Here I speak about civil engineering and you will find my various video lectures regarding various topics of civil engineering over here. So till the last video lectures we were studying about the application of fluid dynamics in various fields like pipe flow or in different flow measurement devices. Now we are moving on to the new chapter, that is boundary layer theory, in which was first explained by Sir Brandel at 1904. When a real fluid will flow over a solid body or a solid wall, the particles of the fluid will adhere to the boundary and there will be no condition of slip. We know that this is the adhesive property of the fluid, wherein one fluid which is flowing through some certain material or certain body within which the fluid is flowing, it will adhere to the wall or the boundary of that solid body, so and ensuring that there is no condition of slip. So now we can also include that the velocity of the fluid particle close to the boundary will have equal velocity as that of the velocity of the boundary. So if you have one pipe, suppose, and fluid is flowing through it, the fluid particles which are close to the boundary of the pipe, suppose, these fluids are supposed to have, will have equal velocity as that of the boundary, and that is suppose almost equal to zero. If we assume that the boundary is stationary or velocity of the boundary is zero, then the velocity of fluid particles adhere or very close to the boundary will also have zero velocity. That's quite natural, that if the fluid particle is adhering to the body of the pipe within which it is flowing, or suppose the plate within which it is flowing, if the fluid particle is adhering to it, then it is certainly that the velocity will be equal to the velocity of the particular wall of the body, and that is actually equal to zero if it is stationary. So if we move away from the boundary, the velocity of the fluid particles will also be increasing, changing from zero at the surface of boundary to the free stream velocity u of the fluid in a direction normal to the boundary. So therefore, if we move from the boundary towards the center, or suppose away from the boundary as much as possible, it will also be increasing changing from zero at the surface of the boundary. Of course, it is zero at the boundary surface of the stationary boundary, to the free stream velocity u of the fluid in a direction of the boundary, normal to the boundary. So finally, if we consider the centermost part of the pipe, or the centermost part of the place between two plates, suppose, it will have the velocity quite equal to that of the free stream velocity, suppose it is capital U. So you can say that the velocity of a fluid particle will vary from zero to the max possible velocity, suppose if it is U, in that particular pipe. So according to the boundary layer theory, fluid flow around the solid boundary might be divided in two regions as mentioned and displayed in the following figure. So what are they? First region, a very thin layer of fluid called the boundary layer in the immediate region of the solid boundary, where the variation of the velocity of the fluid particles from zero at the surface of the stationary body to the free stream velocity u of the fluid will take place. So first of all, there is a certain boundary layer, suppose this, within which this transition will take place. From here, suppose the velocity is zero at this place near the solid body, which is suppose at rest, and at a certain point near the boundary layer, the velocity is about to achieve a value which is equal to the free stream velocity, that is u. So this transition, wherein this transition will take place, this is called our first region. So very thin layer of fluid called the boundary layer in the immediate region of a solid boundary, where the variation in the fluid of the particles from zero at the surface of the stationary boundary to the free stream velocity capital U of the fluid will take place. Shear stress applied by the fluid over the wall will be determined with the help of the following equation, and that is of course our Newton's law of viscosity, that is tau is equal to mu times du upon dy. Second region will be the just the region outside the boundary layer, and the velocity of the fluid particles will be constant outside the boundary layer and will be similar with the free stream velocity. So it is thus said that beyond this boundary the fluid will have no influence of this particular solid body, and thus the velocity of the fluid particles here is quite similar to that of the free stream velocity, that is suppose u. So it's like that the velocity will be zero near the solid body and will keep on transforming from zero to u until a certain limit, and you can say that the solid body will be influencing this much layer of fluid around it, and thus up to this mark you can say this is the boundary layer, and beyond this will be the free stream velocity, and you will be calling it the second region. So these are the two regions that will possibly occur when there is a solid body present in a free streaming fluid. So let's read about laminar boundary layer. So now let us consider the flow of a fluid over a smooth thin and flat plate. Let us assume that this thin and flat plate is located parallel to the direction of the fluid flow as displayed in the following figure. So here is the fluid is flowing with a free stream velocity u, and here we have a particular plate which is in the direction parallel to the velocity of the flow, parallel to the direction of the flow. So now let us consider that the fluid is flowing with a stream velocity capital U, this is given here, and with zero pressure gradient on one side of the stationary plate. So now, as we have already discussed, that when a real fluid will flow over a solid body or a solid wall, the particles of fluid will adhere to the boundary and there will be condition of no slip. We can also conclude that the velocity of the fluid particles close to the boundary will have equal velocity as that of the velocity of the boundary. So it is obvious that whenever the real fluid will flow over a solid body or the solid wall, the particles of fluid will adhere to the boundary and there will be thus condition of no slip. And we can also conclude that the velocity of the fluid particles close to the boundary will have equal velocity of that of as that of the velocity of the boundary. So that thing which we have already read is quite explained over here, that the velocity near to the boundary of the fluid will be equal to that of the stationary plate, and that is equal to zero. As we assume that the plate is stationary and therefore the velocity of the fluid flow over the surface of the plate will therefore be zero. So now if we move away from the plate, the velocity of the fluid particles will also be thus increasing. So that is what we read in the previous section. Therefore, there will be the presence of velocity gradient due to the variation of velocity of fluid particles near the surface of the fluid. And this thing which we studied over here, it is known as the velocity gradient. We know it since the Newton's law of viscosity in the first chapter, that this thing is quite the Newton's law of, quite follows the Newton's law of viscosity, and it will be like the du upon dy, that is the velocity gradient of this particular in this particular flow near the stationary plate. So next let us read about the laminar zone. The length of the plate from the leading edge up to the laminar boundary layer exists will be termed as the laminar zone. AB indicates the laminar zone in above figure. So let us again study the figure, that suppose this is a boundary layer that is being formed, that is in this, within this part there will be the change in the velocity of the fluid. So suppose just consider this part up to this line only. So this is known as a laminar boundary layer, and the change in velocity will take place up to this much only, and you can say that this flow will be laminar over here and will have only one direction of the fluid will have only one direction of flow, just as in case of a laminar flow, it will be having parallel streamlines. And until this layer, that is the laminar boundary layer, there will be a change, certain change in the velocity, and thus we will get the velocity gradient until here, and then you will have a constant streamline of constant velocities which will be flowing beyond this layer. So now length of the plate from the leading edge up to the laminar boundary layer exists, that is the laminar will be determined with the help of the formula, that is this thing. Laminar boundary layer will be determined by this formula, 5 into 10 to the power 5 is equal to u times x upon v, where v naught, sorry, this is nu, where nu is the kinematic viscosity of the fluid, capital U is the free stream velocity of the fluid, and x is the distance from the leading edge up to which the laminar boundary layer exists. So next we have a part, next part, which is a turbulent boundary layer. So again, let's come to the figure. Until this portion, that is from A to E, we will have the laminar boundary layer, and from F to G we will have the turbulent boundary layer, and within E to F it will be a transition zone. So you can see this, that this point is known as the leading edge of the plate, where actually the obstruction, or you can say the change in velocity will take place, will start taking place, and the flow will stay laminar up to this extent. Beyond this, beyond E, there will be a certain change in the flow, and it will behave as both laminar and turbulent, and it will be actually the transition zone from laminar to turbulent, and finally from F, at FG we will be having a flow which is turbulent, and there is no fixed direction of flow, just like turbulent flows, and the streamlines will be flowing haphazardly, just as in case of a turbulent flow, and thus this layer will be known as the turbulent boundary layer. So let's now just read about the theory of the turbulent boundary layer. If the length of the fluid is plate is greater than the value of x, which is determined from the above equation, so there's a particular condition that in this equation we are getting the value of x, that is until which the boundary layer will be laminar, and if the length of the plate is greater than the value of x, which is determined from the above equation, the thickness of the boundary layer will keep increasing in the downstream direction. Therefore, the thickness of the boundary layer will keep on increasing in the downstream direction. Now, if the plate, suppose this thing, this much is the value of the x, AE is the value of x. So, if the length of the plate is up to this much or smaller to this, then we will have only a laminar zone of flow, and this boundary layer will be known as a laminar boundary layer. But if the length exceeds that value, and thus we will have a greater length of the boundary layer, and at the end we will thus be experiencing boundary layer as to be the turbulent boundary layer, because the turbulent flow will be prevalent over there. The laminar boundary layer will become unstable, and movement of fluid particles within it will be disturbed and irregular, just as it happens in turbulent flow. It will lead to a transition from laminar to turbulent boundary layer. This small length over the boundary layer flow changes from laminar to turbulent will be termed as transition zone BC. So we have shown in the figure that this is the transition zone. Suppose BC, it is denoted by here. This is the transition zone, BC. Further downstream, the transition zone the boundary layer will be turbulent and the layer of boundary layer will be determined as the turbulent boundary layer. So let's now discuss about the boundary layer thickness. So first of all, boundary layer, what is boundary layer thickness? Boundary layer thickness is defined as the distance from the surface of solid body measured in the y direction up to a point where the velocity of flow is 0.99 times of the free stream velocity of the fluid. So the boundary layer is that amount of thickness. It is that thickness of layer. Suppose this is this much thick layer, within which there will be the distance from the surface of the solid body measured in the y direction up to a point where the velocity flow of the flow is 0.99 times. That is, there will be an increase in the velocity. That is, we will have a velocity gradient until a point where the velocity will reach a value 0.99 times that of the free stream. And beyond that, it will have the velocity of the free stream, that is u. So we will have a velocity of 0.99 u up to this place, and up to this place we will know this much thickness as the boundary layer thickness. We can also define the boundary layer thickness as the distance from the surface of the body up to a point where the velocity reaches to 99% of the free stream velocity of the fluid. So this was about the boundary layer thickness. So apart from the boundary layer thickness, there are three more thicknesses. Let us just see them. That is, first is the displacement thickness, next is the momentum thickness, and again at last we have the energy thickness. So we will derive all the equations regarding the momentum thickness, displacement thickness and energy thickness, and before that we will just read out the definition of these particular thicknesses. Displacement thickness is defined as the distance measured perpendicular to the boundary of the solid body by which the boundary should be displaced to compensate for the reduction in flow rate on account of boundary layer formation. So this is that much amount of thickness that is measured perpendicular to the boundary. Of course, we will measure perpendicular to the boundary of the solid body by which the boundary should be displaced. And this much layer of boundary should be displaced so that it must compensate for the reduction in the flow rate on account of the boundary layer formation. So we know that presence of a stationary or any object which is as a some kind of obstruction in the fluid body, there will be a certain change in the velocity. So displacement thickness will be that amount of thickness that should be given by that should be displaced for this particular solid body, so that there is the reduction of the flow rate on account of the boundary layer formation is actually compensated. So displacement thickness will be displaced by the symbol delta star, and it will be derived with the help of the continuity equation. The derivation we will do it later, but before that we will read about the momentum thickness. The momentum thickness is defined as the distance measured perpendicular to the boundary of the solid body by which the boundary should be displaced to compensate for the reduction in momentum of the flowing fluid on account of boundary layer formation. So this is that amount of thickness that should be measured perpendicular to the boundary of the fluid by which boundary should be displaced to compensate for the reduction in momentum of the fluid flow. So as there will be a reduction in flow rate in the fluid flow, and that will be compensated by the displacement thickness, similarly the momentum thickness will compensate for the reduction in momentum due to the presence of the solid body, and the boundary layer formation can be the boundary layer can be compensated by this momentum thickness. So for the reduction in momentum of the flowing fluid, and it is denoted by the letter symbol denoted by the symbol theta. Similarly, energy thickness is defined as the distance measured perpendicular to the boundary of the solid body by which boundary should be displaced to compensate for the reduction in kinetic energy of the flowing fluid on account of the boundary layer formation. So similarly, for compensating the reduction in kinetic energy, we have the energy thickness, and it is represented by the symbol delta double star. The bound, note one thing, displacement thickness is denoted by delta star, and boundary layer thickness is denoted by delta. Energy thickness is denoted by delta star, double star, whereas the momentum thickness is denoted by theta. So now let's derive the equation for the for these three symbols, that is delta star, theta and delta double star. So I have drawn a diagram where a fluid is flowing with a free velocity, that is suppose capital U, and a plate suppose is introduced in its path parallelly, and at a and this is the boundary layer that is formed. Suppose I will write it over here that this is the boundary layer, and let us consider that this is laminar, and upon formation of this boundary layer, this is small u, the velocity at a height y in this particular boundary layer. So let's two sections take two sections like section 1 and section 2. So using the considering the mass flow rate in section 1 and 2. So in section 1, suppose rho is the density of the liquid, and delta star is our displacement thickness, or that is the displacement which we are supposed to have, and u is the velocity of the free stream. And now we are taking it as a unit width. Okay, let us take that it has a unit width, this plate has a unit width, take, or you are taking a width per unit section, and let us equate it equal to rho times. Suppose the change in the velocity is capital U minus small u, and dy is the small change in the length. So on integration, let us integrate this thing. Suppose integrating it 0 to delta, or I'll just do the integration over here, integrating it from 0 to delta, we can actually cancel out this rows, alright, and thus solving it for delta star, I'll not do the integration right now, I'll do the integrations while solving the equations whenever I know the equation of this boundary layer or the velocity gradient over here. So if I try to get the delta star without get the value of delta star without integrating the equation, so I will get it something like 0 to delta 1 minus, if I take u in this side or divide the u in this side, so it will be 1 minus small u upon capital U times dy, and this is my displacement thickness. Similarly, if I consider the momentum thickness, the diagram will be quite similar. The only change is that the concept which we will be using, that it will be the momentum flux, will be equal to the mass and flow velocity. So considering the momentum flux in section 1 and section 2, we will see that suppose rho
In place of delta star, I will now write theta times u times again capital U, because momentum is actually mass into velocity. Since mass flow rate was this one, and if I multiply it with the velocity, then I will get the momentum flow rate or the momentum flux. So now this is rho theta u times u is equal to rho. Now I will consider u minus small u, again similar, times dy times a small u I will be multiplying, because small u is the velocity in section 2. So now I can write this as rho capital U square theta equal to rho capital U minus small u times small u dy. Now let's integrate this from 0 to delta, as delta is our boundary layer thickness. So yeah, I'll just tell you one thing, we are integrating it from 0 to delta because delta is our boundary layer thickness, and we are interested only to get the displacement thickness or the momentum thickness, or we will be deriving the energy thickness that we will be deriving in the next part. We are just interested to get the value from within the boundary layer, and we have taken that delta is the boundary layer, actual boundary layer thickness. So our integrations are from 0 to delta only. So 0 to delta u capital U minus small u times small u times dy. And now if I cancel out this rows, and again I will try to get the value of capital theta, value of theta, then it will be something like 0 to delta small u upon capital U times 1 minus small u upon capital U times dy. So it's just simple calculation. Without just removing the integrals, I move out u square in this side, and one part of u I'll divide with this, and so another part of u I'll divide with this. So therefore I am getting one part as small u by u from this, and from this I am getting this, and thus this is our momentum thickness. Now for energy thickness, let us consider that loss of energy as energy flux is equal to half times the mass flow rate and multiplied by the flow velocity, or you can say multiplied by the square of the flow velocity, because we in general we know that energy is half mv square. Alright, so loss of energy as energy flux will be half times the mass flow rate. If we consider the energy flux, that is the energy flow, that will be the mass flow rate times the velocity square, and also a half will be multiplied, half mv square. So the loss of Ke, suppose it is the loss of Ke, it can also be written as half times integration of 0 to delta, as our delta is our boundary layer thickness, rho u, suppose small b is the width, which we will later consider as 1, small b is the width, and multiplied by the u square minus u square. I am taking the change in the velocity times dy. If you are not okay with it, you can neglect it, that's fine, because you must be clear with the basic, that is half mass flow rate times velocity square, and that will be actually, if we apply that in both section 1 and section 2 for our previous diagram, we can say that half for section 1, it will be half mass will be rho u, and in place of delta star or theta we will write delta double star, that will be our energy thickness, we are concerned about this thing, times the again the velocity square. u square. So half times the mass flow rate times the velocity square, and we are considering unit width, so therefore I am not considering this p thing over here. Like similar to the previous derivations, I am considering unit width, and thus it will be, so I will not I'll just multiply 1 with it, and I will not consider the thickness as a valuable part for this equation, and that will be equal to half times rho integration of 0 to delta, and it will be u square minus small u square. I am writing the change in like this way, capital U square minus small u square multiplied by small u times dy. So now therefore the delta star, upon simplifying this equation, can be written as delta double star is equal to 0 to delta u upon capital U times 1 minus u square upon capital U square times dy. So this is our energy thickness. So let's try this question, where assuming that the shear stress distribution in a laminar boundary layer is such that tau is equal to tau naught 1 minus y upon delta. So we have a equation for the shear stress distribution, and we are asked to calculate the displacement and momentum thickness in terms of delta, that is our boundary layer thickness. So we are given that tau is equal to tau naught 1 minus y upon delta, and according to Newton's law of viscosity, it is equal to mu times du upon dy. So that is Newton's law of viscosity. We all know this. And now we can write that, just keeping du on one side, du is equal to tau naught upon mu, taking mu on this side, and 1 minus y upon delta, and multiplying dy on this side. And let's now integrate it, integrating this two, we will get, on integration we will get it, u is equal to tau naught mu, delta is a constant, times delta y minus y square upon 2, plus suppose c is some constant. Now at y equal to 0 and u equal to 0, so if I put y is equal to 0, so this term is actually 0, and also u equal to 0, so therefore the value of c will also be equal to 0. So c value of c will equal to 0 will be equal to 0 if y and u are equal to 0. So now therefore I can write u is equal to tau naught mu times delta, delta y minus y square upon 2, as c is equal to 0. So upon writing this, now again let's take up another thing, that at y is equal to delta, because delta is the maximum possible boundary layer thickness, and we are asked to find every terms like displacement and momentum thickness in terms of delta. At y equal to delta, we will have small u as equal to capital U. and therefore capital U is equal to tau naught mu upon delta, and I will put y as delta, therefore it will be delta square delta into delta minus delta square by 2, and thus capital U will be equal to tau naught delta upon 2 mu. So now we have the value of capital U and the value of small u. So let's divide equation 1 and 2. Suppose this is equation 1, where we got the value of u, and or suppose we are getting the equation for small u, and for capital U we have this equation, and let's divide both the equations. So therefore u upon capital U is equal to this upon this, so it is tau naught delta, sorry, tau naught upon mu delta times delta y minus y square upon 2 upon tau naught delta upon 2 mu, because tau naught delta upon 2 mu is our capital U, and small u is tau naught upon mu delta times delta y minus y square upon 2. So if I have this, so I can further simplify it as 2 times y upon delta, on simplifying this I will be getting this, minus half times y upon delta square. So just by doing this operation I am getting this small u upon capital U, and this term small u upon capital U will be useful for us for the calculation of the displacement and momentum thickness. So small u upon capital U is equal to y upon 2y upon delta minus half times y upon delta square. So let us consider, let y upon delta is equal to suppose t. So therefore small u upon capital U is equal to 2 times t minus half times t square, because it will be difficult to calculate in terms of y upon delta, so it's better to use t. So now therefore delta star, that is our displacement thickness, is equal to 0 to delta 1 minus u upon capital U dy, and that is equal to 0 to delta 1 minus 2t minus t square. Suppose it is, now in place of dy I will write dt. So on integrating this we will get the value as of delta star as delta star is equal to, taking the star is equal to, on solving this I will get t minus t square plus t cube upon 3, and it will be from 0 to t, and thus on putting the value of t we will get it is equal to t upon 3. So that was the value of the delta star. Similarly theta is equal to 0 to delta small u upon capital U times 1 minus small u upon capital U times dy, and now let's put the value of u plus u upon capital U, that is equal to 0 to delta, 0 to delta t minus t square times 1 minus 2t plus t square dt, and thus it will be 0 to delta. And solving this part of the equation, it will be 2t minus 5t square plus 4t cube minus t to the power 4 dt. So on solving this, simplifying this, you will be getting this, and thus theta is equal to, now I'll do the integration, that is t square minus 5 by 3 t cube plus 4 t to the power 4 upon 4, or I'll cancel them out, minus t to the power 5 upon 5, and the value will be from 0 to delta, and thus putting the value of delta, I'll get theta is equal to delta by, or it will be 2 by 15 times delta. So now we were asked about the displacement and momentum thickness only. So if the question also had energy thickness, we could do this as delta double star is equal to integration of 0 to delta small u upon capital U times 1 minus u square upon capital U square times d. dy. So this could be our equation for the energy thickness, and just by putting again the value of u upon capital U, we will get the equation for delta star. So in the next question, for the velocity profile small u upon capital U equal to y upon delta to the power 1 upon 7, calculate the shape factor h. So now we need to know about some one new definition, that is the shape factor h is actually the ratio of the displacement thickness to that of the momentum thickness. So this is the shape factor, the ratio of displacement thickness to that of the momentum thickness. So now we are given small u upon capital U equal to y upon delta to the power 1 by 7. Let y upon delta is equal to suppose t, and therefore small u upon capital U is equal to t to the power 1 upon 7. So now delta star is equal to 0 to delta 1 minus small u upon capital U times dy, and that is equal to 0 to delta 1 minus t to the power 1 by 7 dt suppose, and therefore on solving this, it will be equal to t minus 7 by 8 t to the power 8 by 7, and it will be from 0 to delta, and therefore it is equal to delta upon 8. Similarly, theta is equal to 0 to delta u by capital U times 1 minus small u by capital U times dy, and that is equal to 0 to delta t to the power 1 by 7 times 1 minus t to the power 1 by 7 times dt, and it is equal to 7 by 8 t to the power 8 by 7 minus 7 by 9 t to the power 9/7 and it will be from 0 to delta, which, and therefore on solving this it will be 7/72 delta. Therefore our h, that is the safe factor, is equal to del star upon theta, and that is equal to delta upon 8/7 delta upon 72, and therefore on solving this we will get 1.286. This question could also be written like, somewhat like, the, in place of this, the velocity profile is 1/7 power law. So if we are given in question, in spite of having this equation, the velocity, they could write the question like this, like for the velocity profile as 1/7 power law, calculate the shape factor h. So you have to understand that they are telling the velocity profile as u upon capital U is equal to y by delta to the power 1/7. If they had written the velocity profile is 5 power law, then y by delta to the power 5 would have been our equation. So just keep it in mind, just the change of words won't mean the change of the question.
Now let's move on to the next concept, that is the concept of the drag and lift. Drag, where here we'll be reading about two forces, that is drag and lift, which is experienced by any body when it is placed in a fluid flowing with a free or a uniform velocity. So the drag is that force that acts opposite to the direction of the motion, and drag is caused by the friction and difference in pressure. So first force is a drag force, and which is caused by the friction and difference in pressure, and it acts opposite to the direction of the flow. Lift is that force that acts at a right angle to the direction of the motion through the air. Lift is created by difference in pressure. So again, lift is also created by difference in pressure, and the force, it is a force which acts at the right angle to the direction of the motion along the motion through the air, and it especially happens in air or also even in water. So now suppose this is our fluid flowing, and suppose there is a body. So the drag force will be acting along the direction, and lift force will be acting perpendicular to the direction, and thus the body will be moved at a distance or at a direction resultant of these two. So now let's take up two cases for submerged bodies. So first case is the fluid is moving and the body is stationary. So it's the most general case where the fluid is moving and the body will be stationary. And in this example, I have given a tree which is placed in the direction of the motion of the air. So now if a body is stationary and fluid is moving with a certain velocity, fluid will exert the force over the stationary submerged body, that's right. And the force exerted by the moving air over the surface of a tree could be considered as one of the example of this above case. And air is also a fluid and the tree is submerged inside the air. Now there will be one force which will be applied over the surface of tree by the moving fluid, that is air. And here is the diagram. So it is the most general case when the body will be stationary and fluid will be coming, and with a certain velocity the fluid will exert the force over the stationary submerged body. Next is the fluid is stationary and the body is moving. So suppose the fluid is stationary and the body is moving with a certain velocity, there will be some force reduced by the fluid on the body because the moving body will cut the various layers of the fluid. The swimming through the water could be considered as one of the example of the above case, and forces acting on the submerged bodies will be dividing into the drag force and the lift force. So like, suppose here is the fluid and it is stationary, and there's a swimmer who is actually trying to cut through the various layers of the water. So as just as a swimmer does, he cuts and displaces the various layers of water and he tries to propel himself in the forward direction. So now what will happen? There will be some force induced by this person, and for this the force acting on the submerged body will be thus. So basically this swimmer will not be submerged, he will be partially submerged, but he will divide the force in terms of two forces. One that is in the direction of the motion, that is the drag force, and second that is the lift force. With too much amount of force he will also generate some amount of lift, and that will help him to float across the water body for a long direction, long duration. So the drag force is the force exerted on the body in a direction parallel to the direction of the motion when the fluid is moving and the body is stationary, or the body is moving and the fluid is stationary. So we can have two cases where the fluid is moving and the body is stationary, or the body is moving and the fluid is stationary. In simple, we can say that the force will be applied by the fluid over the body in the direction of the motion and will be termed as the drag force. So the force that will be occurring in a body in the direction of the motion will be the drag force. So the drag force will be represented by the symbol FD. We will represent it by FD, and drag is basically an undesirable effect, and we want to reduce the effect of drag because it takes power to overcome it. But in some cases drag effect is good and beneficial, as in the case of automobiles, brakes and parachutes. Next is the lift force, which is defined as the force exerted on the body in a direction perpendicular to the direction of motion when fluid is moving and body is stationary, or the body is moving and the fluid is stationary. Lift force is represented by the symbol FL. So here is the diagram. We have a freely flowing stream with a velocity capital U, and there's a stationary body which is actually hindering its motion, and thus we will have one FD, that is the drag force, in this direction, and we will also have lift force FL in this direction, and thus as a resultant of this we will have the FR, which is the resultant of the lift and the drag. So now the lift, drag and the lift are given by drag and lift are given by these two equations, CdA rho u square upon 2 and CLA rho u square upon 2, where CD is the coefficient of drag, CL is the coefficient of lift, and A is the area of the body, which is projected area of the body perpendicular to the direction of the flow. So now if we consider this body and we are looking to the body in this direction, in the direction of the motion of the fluid, whatever cross-sectional area we will be seeing for that particular projection, we will consider that area as capital A. FR is the resultant on the body, and rho is the density of the fluid, and V is the relative velocity of the object. So this is the way we get the drag and lift force, and the resultant will be simply by the laws of vector, that is FR is equal to square root of FD square plus FL square. So we were introduced about two coefficient, that is the drag coefficient and lift coefficient. So what is drag coefficient? It is defined as the ratio of the drag force to the dynamic pressure, and drag coefficient could be determined with the help of the following equation as mentioned. So it is the drag force upon A rho v square upon 2, and it is represented by CD. Similarly, we have the lift coefficient, which is basically defined as the ratio of the lift force to the dynamic pressure, and the lift coefficient could be defined with the example with the help of the following equation as mentioned here, and it is CL equal to FL upon A rho v square by 2, where we have half rho v square as the dynamic pressure. So as we defined as the ratio of dynamic pressure, drag force and the dynamic pressure, so the dynamic pressure is given by the rho v square upon 2, and CD and CL are the coefficients of drags and lift. A is again the area of the body, which is projected area of the body perpendicular to the direction of flow. Fr is the resultant force on the body. Rho is the density of the fluid and V is the flow velocity relative to the object. So that was all regarding the concept of drag and lift. And before proceeding on to the numericals related to the drag and lift, we will next consider another topic, that is von Karman momentum integral equation, in the next video lecture. And with the collaboration of this von Karman momentum integral equation and the concept of drag and lift, we will be solving some numericals which will be very useful and which will be very conceptual. So please stay tuned for that in the next video. Till then, if you have any kinds of doubt, please post them in the comment section. Also like and share my video. Subscribe to the channel if you are new. Thank you.